Welcome to Stonehenge, a prehistoric site on Salisbury Plain, about 90 miles west of London. It has been a mystery for thousands of years for three reasons. First, no one is exactly sure how it was built. Second, no one is exactly sure who built it. And third, no one is exactly sure why it was built, although there are several theories. Stonehenge consists of a ring of about 100 standing stones, each around 13 feet high, 7 feet wide, and weighing around 25 tons. The stones are set within earthworks in the middle of the most dense complex of Neolithic and Bronze Age monuments in England, including several hundred burial mounds. Archaeologists believe it was constructed from 3000 BC to 2000 BC. So what exactly does the word Stonehenge mean? Archaeologists define henges as earthworks consisting of a circular banked enclosure with an internal ditch. Stonehenge was constructed in three phases, requiring more than 30 million hours of labor. The first Stonehenge was probably built around 3100 BC. It was a large henge comprising a ditch, bank, and the Aubrey holes, which are round chalk pits about 3 feet wide and deep with steep sides and flat bottoms. They form a circle about 284 feet in diameter. Excavations have revealed cremated human bones in some of the chalk filling, leading some to believe that this was a burial site. But the holes themselves were probably made as part of a religious ceremony, perhaps holding up a ring of timber posts, creating a circle of timber within a circular ditch. Shortly after this stage, Stonehenge was abandoned and left untouched for over 1,000 years. The second and most dramatic stage of Stonehenge started around 2150 BC. Some 82 bluestones from the Preseli Mountains in southwest Wales were transported 240 miles to the site. It is thought that these stones, some weighing 4 tons each, were dragged on rollers and sledges made out of greased tree trunks to the water and then loaded onto rafts. They were carried by water along the south coast of Wales and up various rivers before being dragged overland again. The final stage of the journey was mainly by water to Salisbury. More recent hypotheses have them transporting the bluestones with supersized wicker baskets or a combination of ball bearings, long grooved planks, and teams of oxen. Once at the site, these stones were set up in the center to form an incomplete double circle. During the same period, the original entrance of the circular earthwork was widened and a pair of heel stones were erected. Also, the nearer part of the avenue was built, aligning with the midsummer sunrise. The third stage of Stonehenge, around 2000 BC, saw the arrival of the Sarsen stones, which were almost certainly brought from about 25 miles north of Stonehenge. The largest of the Sarsen stones transported to Stonehenge weighed 50 tons, and transportation by water would have been nearly impossible. The stones could have only been moved using sledges and ropes. Modern calculations show that it would have taken 500 men using leather ropes to pull one stone, with an extra 100 men needed to lay the huge rollers in front of the sledge. Horizontal lintel stones, which topped the exterior ring of the Sarsen stones, were fitted using a certain type of joint, methods used in modern woodworking. A lintel is a structural horizontal block that spans a space or opening between two vertical supports. These were arranged in an outer circle with a continuous run of lintels. Around 1500 BC, inside the circle, five trilithons, or three-piece structures, were placed in a horseshoe arrangement whose remains we can still see today. Some remain only as stumps below ground level. Now, as early as the 1970s, some scientists have suggested that glaciers, not humans, did most of the heavy lifting. However, most archaeologists have wondered how the forces of nature could possibly have delivered the exact number of stones needed to complete the circle. Personally, I can buy into the theory that large heavy stones could have been transported by land on greased logs and by sea with large enough rafts that could hold several tons, but what I don't understand is how they could have lifted the 25 to 50 ton stones upright once they got here. Did they do it with ropes by hand? Did they use a crane? The most powerful 21st century crane can lift 600 tons, but I just can't picture the builders using a primitive crane thousands of years ago that could lift 25 to 50 tons. Which means that there is only one other explanation. Aliens. Okay, that might be a bit far-fetched. Or is it? So who built Stonehenge? According to a 12th century writer, Stonehenge is the handiwork of the wizard Merlin, friend and confidant of King Arthur. While many believed this for centuries, the monument's construction predates Merlin, or at least the real-life figures who are said to have inspired him, by several thousand years. Other early hypotheses attributed its building to the Saxons, Danes, Romans, Greeks, or Egyptians. In the 17th century, archaeologist John Aubrey made the claim that Stonehenge was the work of the Celtic high priests known as the Druids. Even today, people who identify as modern Druids continue to gather at Stonehenge for the summer solstice. However, in the mid-20th century, radiocarbon dating demonstrated that Stonehenge stood more than 1,000 years before the Celts inhabited the region, eliminating this theory. Many modern historians and archaeologists now agree that several distinct tribes of people contributed to Stonehenge, each undertaking a different phase of its construction. Bones, tools, and other artifacts found on the site seem to support this hypothesis. The first stage was achieved by Neolithic agrarians, who were likely indigenous to the British Isles. Later, it is believed, groups with advanced tools and a more communal way of life left their stamp on the site. Some have suggested that they were immigrants from the European continent, but many scientists think they were native Britons descended from the original builders. So why was Stonehenge built? There is strong archaeological evidence that Stonehenge was used as a burial site, at least for part of its long history. This happened during its second phase, and the bones found all belonged to males 25 to 40 years old in good health, who showed little signs of hard labor or disease, which meant they could have been elite members of society, maybe even political leaders. However, most scholars believe it served other functions as well, either as a ceremonial site, a religious pilgrimage destination, a final resting place for royalty, or a memorial erected to honor and perhaps spiritually connect with distant ancestors. In the 1960s, astronomer Gerald Hawkins suggested that the cluster of stones operated as an astronomical calendar, with different points corresponding to astrological phenomena such as solstices, equinoxes, and eclipses. However, critics theorize that Stonehenge's builders probably lacked the knowledge necessary to predict such events, or that England's dense cloud cover would have obscured their view of the skies. More recently, signs of illness and injury in other human remains unearthed at Stonehenge led a group of British archaeologists to speculate that it was considered a place of healing, perhaps because blue stones were thought to have curative powers. So bottom line, even after thousands of years, we still have a mystery on our hands, one that may never be solved.